Hi, I'm Iain, and this is my Chicago Electric Mig 170 MIG welder from Harbor Freight. Now, you might notice something slightly different about this one. This thing jutting out right here, and this torch. This is a Tweco style torch with a 15-foot lead going to a Euro-style connector. Why do I have this on my welder, you ask? Well, the nice thing about putting a Euro-style connector on this is that it opens up the possibilities as to what kind of accessories you can put on your MIG welder. And in this case, I've got a Tweco-style gun with, like I said, a 15-foot hose, so that gives me a lot more flexibility to move around. The other thing it does is with a couple added parts and a switch on inside of this thing, you can hook a spool gun to this welder and weld aluminum. So that's what we're going to do today, is we're going to take the stock MIG 170 and turn it into this welding system. Before we go ahead and start tearing into the MIG welder, let's take a second and look at the parts you're going to need in order to do this conversion. Now, the biggest thing you're going to need is the new torch with the Euro style connector on the end. And if you go on eBay and you search for Euro MIG gun or something to that effect, you'll find a whole bunch of different styles and brands of MIG guns that have the Euro style connector. I went with the Tweco 15 foot MIG gun clone with the end from HTP America, because I've gotten other stuff from them before and I've been really happy with them. But also because, unlike the Benzel MIG guns, because this uses the Tweco consumables, I can drive for 2 minutes down to my local welding supplier and get all the consumables I want, plus a liner for this thing, everything I need for it, right there. So that's one thing to keep in mind, is if you get some other type of MIG gun that takes parts that are popular, say, in Europe, you can get the parts online, and they're real cheap, and there's usually free shipping, and they'll ship it to your door. But if you're in a pinch, in the middle of a project, and your very last tip, the wire burns back into it, and it's toast, it's nice to be able to just run down the street and get parts for it. So that's just one thing to keep in mind with the MIG gun. Once you've chosen which MIG gun you want to use, it's time to take a look at what front panel connector you want to use. Now, they're all going to be the standard air-cooled Euro-style quick connect coupling. Now, the thing to watch out for is there is a difference, because they have a water-cooled one that has some extra jets in here, and it's a little bit bigger and stuff like that. But for the air-cooled, as long as it says Euro-style connector and it looks like that, there's only one size of them, so you're safe with that. One thing that did take me by surprise a little bit on this thing is on the plastic housing that bolts onto the front of the welder, there's these two holes. And, you know, I got it, and I'm staring at these holes, and they weren't threaded or anything, and I thought, boy, I gotta believe that's set screws, because I wouldn't want all that's keeping the brass part in to be where it attaches to the drive mechanism, because, you know, if you trip over the gun or something, that's going to be a lot of force pulling this thing out, and I didn't like that. So I went online, I started looking at these things, and it turns out they normally have two set screws here. Well, there were no set screws in my package, so what I did is I just grabbed a tap and I threaded these holes to 5/16 by 24. And so I went to the hardware store and I got two set screws that I'm going to thread in there, and that'll take care of that. So that's just one thing to be aware of. Now you're going to need one more thing in order to do the real basic conversion of the MIG torch, and that is a solenoid for the shielding gas. Because the original torch this welder came with, one reason why everybody complains that the trigger is so stiff is that there's actually a valve in the handle, and that is what turns the shielding gas on and off. So every time you squeeze it, it's working a set of contacts to turn on the welder and the drive mechanism, and it's also pushing up on a plunger that opens up the shielding gas. So in order to use a torch that doesn't have the internal valve, you need the 24 volt solenoid. And this one has a 1/4 inch hose barb on one side and 1/4 inch national pipe thread on the other, and a jam nut. Now, the nice thing about the jam nut is I can drill a hole in the back of the welder that this sticks out, and then tighten this nut down on the outside, and that's the mounting setup for the solenoid. So that's all it takes to just replace this MIG gun with a nicer MIG gun. Now, if you want to go one step farther, you can go ahead and get some number 4 welding lead. I happen to have 12.5 feet of it right here because I got 25 feet of it and I cut it in half or something else. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to replace the number 6 gauge 6-foot long ground lead that came standard on this thing with 12.5 feet of number 4 welding lead. In order to do that, I also need some of these lugs that I picked up at Tractor Supply, and they're just number 4 3/8 stud. That means it's a 3/8 diameter hole, which happens to be what the bolt in the ground clamp and the terminal post inside the welder have. So, two of those in a pack, plus the wire, and that's all you need to then upgrade the ground. If you want to go all out on this thing, which is the original reason why I started to do this conversion, was I want to use a spool gun on this thing to weld some aluminum. If you're going to do the spool gun route, you're going to need a double pull, double throw toggle switch from Radio Shack. You're going to need some extra wire to go in the welder. That happens to be 18 gauge stranded hookup wire. And then you're going to need one of these 4-pin microphone connectors, and then the matching connector on the spool gun end. And what this is going to do is go right on the front panel, so that way when you plug in your spool gun, nothing really happens here because you aren't going to be feeding the aluminum wire in here, but you are going to be getting your shielding gas out of this hole, and then your trigger contacts still work this hole. Well, you need 2 more contacts somewhere that can feed the gun the power to actually run the little motor. And that's where this comes in. So this is going to supply the gun with the motor power. Trigger still works these 2. Gas still comes out here. Nothing comes out here because you're not using the drive mechanism in the welder. And this switch diverts the power from the internal drive mechanism to the spool gun. And we'll go out over that when we put it in. But those are the parts you're going to need to complete this conversion. Okay, the first step of this conversion is to take the case off the welder. And you've got four screws on the top, and then a whole bunch of screws on this side. And then the whole thing lifts straight off. And then, you just take the whole cover off. Okay, now we're going to start messing with stuff. I'm going to go ahead and take this off. And I see these big screws. I think they hold the wire drive to the actual sheet metal. Maybe. So we've got this that looks like a lawnmower throttle cable. That is the actual metal liner that goes out to the MIG gun that the steel wire used to go through. So now that that's free, we can see what else is holding this thing in. Okay, I've got the two wires that worked the trigger. Now, because we're going to be replacing that with the Euro connector that has its own two wires, for the time being, I'm just going to snip these. Now, the reason I'm just snipping them is so that way they're still attached to that board wherever they go for the time being, so I'll be able to find where they attach when I'm ready for them. So we got that off. Now we got to see what else is in here. Okay, we've got the power wire that comes from the screw terminal down there, and let's see what's holding that on. I don't think, yep, there's actually nothing holding that on. So I can get that up out of there. It's kind of a stiff cable. Okay, so now we've got the trigger wires cut. We've got the power cable out. We've got the liner free. Now the only thing that's left is the hose for the gas. So the hose for the gas is attached by a couple zip ties. So I'm just going to snip zip ties. We can put new zip ties in afterwards. There, and now we should be able to get the gas line out. Yep, and we did. So now I can just go ahead and wiggle that whole assembly out through there. I'm going to try and put the quick connect in to just see how things line up. Now already I can tell I'm going to have to trim this brass tube down some. But this little stainless tube fits in where the liner went really well. So that's good. And as far as the diameter is concerned, it fits in there really well, and I'll be able to tighten that down, and when we put the other cover on, that should stay very nicely. The issue is right here. The hole for the original torch lead isn't big enough to have the gas line and the wires go through, especially since this piece is going to be going in farther when I trim the brass threaded part off. So I need to mark where I need to enlarge this hole. Now, as you can see, the thing's not centered on the hole, so I don't want to just enlarge the entire hole. I just want to enlarge where stuff is going to hit. So to do that, I'm going to just take a paint pen and I'm going to hold it in place with my thumb so that way it stays in the position it wants to be in. And then I'm just going to mark where it needs to be enlarged. And that is the super precise drawing of where I need to enlarge this hole. I'm going to go ahead and remove as much material as I can with the step bit and then clean up the rest with the Dremel tool. Okay, let's try it now. And that's perfect right there. I got space all the way around. You want to make sure that the actual threaded brass part isn't touching the case, because if it's touching the case, when you pull the trigger, this whole thing is going to be at the same voltage as the tip of the gun. So if you happen to have the ground lead hitting the case, or this thing bumped up against the welding table, it could short out to the case. So you want to make sure you've got a gap all the way around. And we do. So now we can go ahead and figure out how much of this brass piece I need to take off. In order to figure out how much of this threaded brass piece I need to cut off in order for this thing to fit in the welder, I first have to figure out where it fits in this thing, so that way I know how much is actually going to be sticking out the back of this plastic piece. So what I'm going to do is I put the set screws in. I'm just going to put the plastic piece over it and then take the end of the MIG gun and I'm going to thread it on. There. I'm going to get it good and snug like that. Then I'm going to put the whole brass thing into the plastic and butt the two together like that. And now I'm going to pull it out about an eighth of an inch. So that way, if the spool gun or some other MIG gun that I ever get has a slightly different sized ring on it, I know it's not going to bottom out on that. And I don't know if this is the technical way to do this, because I didn't get any instructions on how to do this, so it just seemed like this would make sense that you'd leave a gap. Okay, so let's take a look here. And I've got this pushed in where it's going to be, and the thing you have to watch out for is this stainless steel tube that takes the place of the wire wound liner from the original lead has to clear this little edge of the plastic part that holds the drive roll on, because if it sticks out farther than that, you're never going to be able to change these drive rolls because you won't be able to turn it. So just make sure you can still turn it there. Under ideal circumstances, you would want to move that thing just as close to that wheel as possible, so when you're running 24/1000ths wire, it doesn't bird's nest as easily, but you know, there's only so much we can do here. So make sure you can still get this off to change the drive rolls. Now, I'm just going to measure from the back of this plastic to the front of this sheet metal, and that'll be how much we have to trim off this brass tube. We know we need to take 3/4 of an inch off this threaded brass piece. So to do that, first I've loosened up that set screw right there, and now I can unscrew this whole brass thing from the great big brass thing. Okay, we can move the connector out of the way. Now, you see, there's another set screw, and its purpose is to hold the stainless steel tube into the brass tube. And I've gone ahead and loosened that up, so now I can pull the stainless steel tube out of the threaded brass tube. So, this is the end that threads into the connector body. So I want to take 3/4 of an inch off this end, and I can get these nuts out of the way, so that way I don't have to deal with them. You want to leave one nut on when you cut it, so that way when the threads get slightly messed up from cutting, you can back the one remaining nut off, and that'll clean up the threads at the end. Otherwise, it'll be very hard to get these nuts to thread back on here after it's cut. But I'm going to get rid of those for the time being, because they're just going to get in the way of the saw. So I'm going to cut off 3/4 of an inch here. Now, I'm also going to have to cut off 3/4 of an inch here. Otherwise, it's going to stick out this way too far, and that'll mess up the inside of the connector. But you'll see there's an E-clip right here, and it's tapered down at the end. So I don't want to cut off 3/4 of an inch here. This end is just cut square, so I'm going to cut off 3/4 of an inch right here. And then when I put it back in, everything will be back to normal. Well, I cut off 3/4 of an inch on both the brass and the stainless steel parts, and I reassembled it, and sure enough, it fits perfectly now. It's just got enough space that I can still take this off to access the drive roll, and this plastic face piece is flat on the sheet metal. I'll now go ahead and rig up the power wire that gives power to this brass block, and once I do that, we can go ahead and figure out the hole locations for mounting the faceplate. One thing I forgot to mention when I was talking about the parts and materials you would need to do this conversion, you're going to need 18 inches of number 4 welding lead that you can put ends on to bring the power from the binding post up to the brass block. And originally, the lead that went to the torch, that went down in and out here, had red shrink tubing on it. I didn't have any red shrink tubing that size, so I put blue on mine, basically anything other than black, just so that way, once it's all fed in here and all you see sticking out is this little piece, you can tell it apart from the actual ground lead. Now I'm just going to feed the cable through here. Whoops, got to have the end with the heat shrink on it. Now, depending on how wide the lugs are that you get, you might have to enlarge this hole a little bit. There. And now, just going to have that go down here. What I have right now is I have one of the normal nuts on here, then I have the big nut with a big round spot on it that I put 3 layers of shrink tubing on to beef it up a little bit so that way the ridges that are built in to this thing that used to clamp the hose for the old torch in place, we'll be able to grab onto this to help hold this all in place. Then I've got the ring terminal from the power cable, and now I'm putting the last of the normal nuts on. And this is where it starts to get tricky, because there's not a whole lot of space for all this. And now we're going to try and get this thing positioned where it needs to be. So I'm going to put the drive roll back in place and the plastic retainer, because we've got to adjust these nuts so that way that stainless steel part isn't interfering with that. The nice thing about this setup is by adjusting the nuts, you can adjust this thing's position in and out, so you can really fine-tune where this thing is. There. That's perfect right there. So now I can go ahead and tighten down these two nuts together to get a good grip on the ring terminal, and then I can turn this nut so it butts up against the front of the drive assembly. I was able to get the two trigger wires and the gas hose run up through a notch that was already existing in the bottom of the feed unit, and I was able to get everything put back in. So now, let's go ahead and attach the plastic front. The easiest way to do that is to simply line it up so it looks like it's correct up and down, and then just lock it in place with the set screws. Now all I'm going to do is just drill right through those holes with a 1/4-inch drill bit, and I can bolt it together. As it turns out, I'm not totally done on this side because I still need to drill the hole for the toggle switch to be able to turn it from standard mode into spool gun mode. So I figured out right here on this one, yeah, right there, there's nothing behind it. So I can drill into there, and this needs a 7/16 hole. So I will just use the step drill. Double check, make sure there's nothing back there. There isn't. Gotta go one more. There. Let's just see. Yep, that's the one. I've gone ahead and soldered the wires to the toggle switch before I put it in the welder, because once it gets back in there, it's going to be impossible to solder to. These wires, these two wires that connect in the center to the common contact in the switch, come from the circuit board, and they're what give the power to the motor. These two that come off of one end of the switch are what connect to the drive motor in the welder. These two that come off the other side connect to the new connector on the front that the spool gun will attach to. So again, you've got the board connection coming into the center, because it's either going to connect from the center over here or the center over there. So the center is the common one. That's the power coming in. Then you have the drive motor on the welder on one side, spool gun motor on the other side. It's time to connect the new trigger wires to the old trigger wires. And I know these are the old trigger wires because they're cut off and just sitting there. So what I'm going to do, because I don't want to have to pull the pins out of this connector, crimp new pins onto this, and then shove it into the connector, I'm just going to leave myself about that much wire and just cut it off. And these old trigger wires seem to be in shrink tubing, so I'm going to say, yep, I can just slide that right off. The new trigger wires, I'm just going to give myself a few inches extra, so that way I know I've got enough, and I'm just going to trim those off. So now I just splice them together. This is the control board for the MiG 170. And I did some poking around with the multimeter, and I found that those two terminals right there have 21 volts across them whenever the trigger is pressed. So I'm going to use those for the gas solenoid. I have a feeling those are designed to be for a gas solenoid, and the reason they never got populated was because this thing wasn't designed to have a gas solenoid. Now, you'll notice there's some stuff unpopulated up here. All the wires are hooked up and the control board is back in place, so now it's time to turn our attention to the final thing, and that is the gas solenoid. Now, I'm going to put the gas solenoid up in this corner over here because I really don't want it over in the compartment with the wire spool, because I don't want to have the gas hose and the wires out where they can get bumped when you're trying to put wire in this thing. So I want to keep all that stuff over on this side. And I'm going to put it to this edge as far as possible, so that way when this thing is on the cart with the shielding gas cylinder behind it, this thing isn't hitting up against the cylinder. So I'm going to keep it as far this way as possible and just move it down enough that this thing clears the top of the welder. So I think, looking at this thing, I'm going to drill the hole right about here. Yep. On this solenoid, it's got three spade terminals. This spade terminal down here is connected directly to the brass, and that is a ground terminal in case you wanted to attach this to the machine's safety ground. In this case, we don't really need to use this because it's getting bolted to the metal chassis of this thing, and the chassis is already grounded, so we don't need more ground. We're only concerned with these two spade terminals that is what the coil is attached to. And for a solenoid, it doesn't care which is the positive and which is the negative. So all I'm going to do is attach one to that side and one to this side. And again, these wires come from the control board, and they give it 21 volts whenever we pull the trigger. The only other thing we got to hook up is the actual gas line out to the new Euro-style quick connector. And then we've got this little cheap thing that makes us feel better about it. I don't know what that actually accomplishes, but it makes us feel good. So now that we've got that all hooked up, we can go ahead and fit this in right there, and then put the jam nut on. This thing is almost ready to go back together. Well, the one thing I'm not real happy about with this setup is right here, the fact that the gas hose is hitting the edge of the heat sink. So, to give it a little bit more protection, I'm just going to put this piece of heat shrink tubing on it, and I'm going to shrink it down just so that way we've got an extra layer between the edge of this heat sink and the hose. Now, it could turn out that eventually I've got to replace this hose because of that right here. I don't think I'll have to, but if I do, I will update the description box to say, yeah, this wasn't such a good idea. But I'm going to try it and see how it goes. here's the finished product. We've got solenoid installed. I've got everything zip tied back together so that way it's not just flopping around in there. On the front, we've got the connector for the spool gun. We've got the Euro connector. On this side, we've got the 4-gauge torch lead connector and the 4-gauge ground connector. And we've got the switch to switch off the internal drive system and to power on the spool gun's drive system. So, now, all I'm going to do is clean it out with compressed air because I need to get all the metal shavings out of the bottom of this thing. And we can go ahead and try this thing out. Okay, I got this thing all put back together. We're back in the barn and we're going to go ahead and install this roll of 0.030 solid MIG wire in it. So all I got to do is open up the door, kind of brace it with your elbow because it likes to fall down on my head. Take that off. Take these off. And then put the spool of wire, get it up on that little stepped washer on the back. Put the one on the front on. Then you put the little spring and the knob, and you just want to put enough tension on this thing that it doesn't want to keep rolling. We can take the wire off, and I'm just going to snip the bent piece because the bent piece won't feed real well. Now we just go ahead and feed it in to the new Euro style connector. And I'm just going to keep pushing it into the torch a ways. That's probably good. Now I'm just going to swing that down. And the tension was already adjusted from when I was using it before with the old torch, so I don't think I'm going to have to mess with that. But that's all you have to do on this end. Now, let's just take a look at the torch and feed the wire through the rest of the way. To feed the wire the rest of the way through the 15-foot cable to the gun, I'm going to let the welder do the work for me. To start out, I'm going to pull the cone off the gun. Next, I'm going to take the tip out. That I just use my MIG pliers for, with a little hole designed for removing the tips. And I'll set that aside. And now, I'm going to turn on the MIG welder and crank the wire feed speed to max. So that way, you know, I get this over with as soon as possible. Now, ideally, you want this cable stretched out as straight as possible for doing this, but for the sake of the video, this is going to be as straight as it gets. So let's see if it can do it. I feel something coming. And there it is. Okay, so we know we can feed wire through the 15-foot gun. Now, all I'm going to do is put the tip back on, tighten it down just a little bit, don't go crazy on it because you'll never get it off again, and put the cone back on. And now I can snip this to about 1/4 inch, which is where I like it.
And now, we're all set to weld with this thing. So, let's go ahead and see what it can do. Well, it tack welds okay. Let's give it a little more wire feed speed.
Okay, let's try this thing out. Well, I'd say that went really well. Other than the first part where I think the shielding gas hadn't fully gone to the end of the hose yet, because that is a 15-foot hose, and I probably should have purged it first. So, note to self, if you do this, let the gas run through the gun a while in order to let it purge. But other than the start, I think that went really well. I'd crank up the wire feed speed a little bit. I was at 6. I was at min 2, 6. I'd bump it up to like 7.5 and call it good for this type of stuff. So I'm really happy with the way this turned out. Now I got 15 feet to play with. I got 12 feet on the ground cable to play with. And I can now hook a spool gun up to it. So I'm very happy with how this turned out. I think you'll be happy if you do this conversion to your MIG 170.